Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Bulldozer, Russian Federation, Slush and Skolkovo. To start with, I want to show you some basics, what we are talking in this coming 27 minutes. First of all, Skolkovo, as such, is not just a technopark. It's not like an innovation project. It's a university. It's research, it's grant financing, it's a place where there Finnish, European, American, whoever startup who wants to establish a business in Russia can easily come there. It's a shortcut to ease up the bureaucracy. It's shortcut to get an access to the biggest market in Europe, for example, in internet usage. I think that's enough as an intro. Secondly, everybody knows that Russia is not only Moscow, it's not only St. Petersburg. Russia is 10 time zones, and we are organizing a massive startup tour now, third year, so we can meet companies, entrepreneurs, investors all over the Russian Federation. And that's why today the presentation and the comments are not about Skolkovo, it's about whole of Russia. So, directly without any other talks, let's move on. This is a Q&A. I have got from you now about 377 questions, and I'm equally splitting this question now to this gentleman. So let's get started. We try to answer to the 12 hottest questions what we have now. So Arkadi, let's start from you. There is a question from the VC, a London-based VC, that 3 years ago he heard first time about the Skolkovo, that Russia is putting emphasizes on startups and entrepreneurship, and he thought that it's just PR, that Russia wants to look modern and cool and something like that. But then he visited this summer in Startup Village and saw thousands of entrepreneurs there. What is this? Was the journalist wrong? Typically they are not, sorry journalists, but I mean, was this particular journalist wrong?
Thank you, Pekka, for the question. Let me just stand up.
Yeah, sure.
It's easier. Hello, everyone. It's good to be back at Slush. Thank you for inviting me back here. It was one of the best experiences I had last year here at Slush. Many people, very crowded. Lots of good experience. So, answering the question, I don't think Russia is the best at making PR. We are better at making things happen. And this is why we decided that we should not just PR innovation approach in Russia, but do things. But first, we made sure that innovation business is fashionable in Russia. We are trying to create the real drive for especially young people to innovate at universities, at research centers, in companies. We are trying to do things that are fashionable for many of young people, and we were able to do so by inviting leaders who already achieved something, like Pekka, like Alexander, like big bosses from big international companies, including Nokia, Intel, Google, and others. And those people are working for Russia and sometimes working in Russia. But second thing we did, we put some money, we added some leadership, and we created a few centers where innovation business can develop. And this is why you can see those hundreds of thousands of people around Russia who already make those businesses, who create startups, who develop startups, and some of them are really successful. Some of them are already making money. So I don't think we can be proud about PR of Russia at this point of time, but we can be proud about some of the success stories in innovation business. Thank you.
Thank you, Arkady. So, Sasha Galitsky next to me, he hates when I call him as the most experienced guy in the VC world in Russia, because he's not so old. even he looks like that he comes from Rolling Stones. But how did you end up, this is a real question, how did you end up to be in a VC business, and what's the difference between the VCs and their behavior in US, UK, Russia, sir?
First of all, when you're tired to build companies, you need to do something else. So I'm tired. I built 5 companies, and I tired in beginning of 2000 and almost became CEO of Evernote, but decided I don't like to run business which not belongs to me. So, and I decided to do something else. So it is how I ended. As VC, I will say that I actually don't see big difference in approach which we see taken in any country. It depends which markets they operate. There's a difference between UK and US. It is the same language, almost the same culture, and the size slightly bigger. The US market slightly much bigger than the UK market. So many UK companies anyway going to US. If you're speaking about all other places except Germany in Europe, they're similar since the local IT market is very tiny, even big Russia. So, and from this point, it is no different with BC operation in Finland, Russia, or some European small country.
Dimitri, you are also coming from the VC, and we have a question also from your VC colleague in the audience. So, what is the biggest weak spot? The weakest spot of the Russian startup ecosystem as of today, from the VC, from the investor standpoint?
Well, besides Russia, we invested in 10 countries across Europe and in Israel and in the United States. So for me, would be difficult to answer this question because I see more things that are in common between Russia and other countries rather than differences. So in terms of ecosystem, we've got talent, obviously. The universities are there. Russian universities are producing 35,000 computer engineers per year, which is a record number. Money is now there. Sasha is sitting here. I'm here. So talent plus money, that the cornerstones of ecosystem. And then there is a secret ingredient, which is entrepreneurs. And then we, of course, we see a lot of emerging entrepreneurs in Russia. Maybe that's one of the differences, because the market economy in Russia is younger than in other countries, so we have less experienced entrepreneurs. And finally, I think from cultural perspective, Russian startups are less focused, and Russians in general are less focused compared to their Western peers. The kind of hard proof of that is if you look at the country size, it kind of proves how we behave. We just research, 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 and then hard to stop anywhere.
Compared to the original program, those of you who were not partying heavily last night in a warm-up party have noticed that there is no Vekselberg. There is Mr. Sitnikov from Skoltech here in the panel. But it's good because the question is particular from our university program. So the question, Skoltech is the technical university part of Skolkovo, and it's jointly done together with an MIT from USA. So the question is the Skoltech open for also other than American and Russian researchers and students, because it's very heavily marketed as a joint. And there is a big question, which is you can answer if you like, is the current political situation, is it kind of stopping the development of Skoltech or this MIT cooperation?
Well, the answer to the first question is yes. We are open to many international partnerships. MIT is our principal partner, which is helping to stand this operation up, giving us the experience, the spirit, the people, the programs we're doing with them. And they were actually the only university which was able to do a project of this scale when we were choosing a partner. But it doesn't mean that we don't engage other universities around the world. We engage leading US universities, European universities, universities in Asia, in the format of doing joint research in our research centers of research, innovation, and education. And that's how we do. That's the main building principle of Skoltech. It's international from get-go. It would be impossible to be local, as the science and scholarship knows no borders. And the answer to the second part of your question is that universities are not involved in politics. We, in fact, now see a surge, it's very interesting, in interest, the Skoltek on behalf of the international students. And we are continuing to very aggressively and actively to hire faculty around the world, including in Europe, in the United States. We're looking towards Asia. So I would say that we're not affected. We're challenged, and but we like a good challenge because you come out of it in better quality and stronger. So that's what we do, and stand upwards.
Okay, Arkadi, it's good to have a deputy prime minister here, so we can ask also about politics, even though I'm not in politics in any country. This is a real question from an entrepreneur from the audience. I have, or my company has 240 people so far in Helsinki and two other countries. We have been planning to start new office in Russia to enter the Russian market because of R&D, but also to sell to Russian consumers. How long we should wait? And when do you expect that the situation of politics is being normalized? Very easy question, sir.
Well, wait for what? I don't think anyone who wants to make business in Russia, especially R&D business, consumer-oriented business in Russia, should wait for anything. Those guys should just come to Russia and start business. No obstacles for that. Good environment. Consumer demand is still growing, not at the same rate as before, but still it's still up from the previous period. Special conditions, special preferential treatment for R&D companies in Russia, including at Skolkovo and other places. If a guy who asked the question will wait, he will lose. He will lose the competition since other people are coming and starting businesses. Politics sometimes is harmful for business and for innovations. Universities are out of politics, that's true. But some people are hesitant, some people are not like running for fortune immediately. We are doing our best in close contact with our European, American, and other partners to find a common ground to stabilize the situation in Ukraine and around, as well as resolving other international issues. Well, right now we have disagreements about some things, but we strongly believe that those disagreements should not lead to confrontation and should not lead to breaking ties among people, among businesses, and within the research and educational community. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sasha, I know that what is your advice for a guy, a Swedish colleague who is here? What is your advice? How to start a business in Russia, and to planning and operate it and sell the products in Russia. From where to start? I know that this is a lecture issue, but you have a 60 seconds precisely based what I hear from my left ear.
Okay, so we more specialize to bring companies from tiny markets to bigger market, but we are taking companies from former Soviet Union, Baltics and Eastern Europe to bigger market and usually to yes. So we have Californian office. But what I learned during this time, since we have 20% of our investment going to inside to develop country, inside companies inside Russia, what I learned, trick the same always. So you need to find the good partners. So first of all, you need to find partners who can lead the deal over there and need to be local people. So everything done by people. So when you find good leadership inside country, after this you will become successful since you know what to do. So it is in US, in Russia, in UK, in China, everywhere.
As you know, we have at the same time the European conference of the business angels here in Helsinki, just by accident at the same time with Slush. So we have one business angel question. Same question, Dimitri, you are kind of a business angel. You don't look like an angel, but can you tell me, for this business angel, if he, or actually, I don't know, he or she wants to touch base with the companies in Russia, where to start that discussion?
They need to ask you, Pekka. You did many angel investments in Russia.
No, конечно, but I mean, Dimitri.
Well, to start investing in Russia, you mean? That's the question. So to start making investments in Russia, I think first thing to do is actually to know the country better. Because spend some time in Moscow, because Russia is much bigger than Moscow. And that was said by Pekka in the beginning, and that's right. We have many other big universities and big sources of talent. So it's very hard to do business in Russia staying outside of Russia. Investments in particular, because you need to be very close to people. Investments, it's mostly about people, mostly about investing in talent. And my second advice is that this angel should rather look for Russian talent than for Russian market, because Russian talent is way bigger relatively to Russian market. And finally, I think I'm a physicist by my first degree, so I like to classify everything, and I see three categories of people who do technology startups. First category are great engineers who want to monetize their knowledge. Second category is entrepreneurs who want to make money, and for them technology is just one space where something happening. And third category who started technology business because it's fashionable.
Yeah, very good.
So look for the first one. I think this is the, for Russia would be a good recipe.
A colleague from Germany was meeting some other colleagues who were been operating in Russia not very lately, they said 20 years ago, and they saw a lot of limitations and regulations regarding business and transferring money and this kind of practical things which we see business as usual here. Arkady, could you list the top five limitations, if there are, for the business, for the startups, like, because I think this is the biggest, well, how do I say, the biggest doubt for doing business in Russia in knowledge-driven businesses like software and so forth?
Well, as in most countries in the world, companies should pay taxes. I guess that's normal. Russian taxes are usually lower than around Europe, at least. And I would say on average level, if you compare it with other countries around the world. But for special institutions like Skolkovo, for instance, we have a special tax treatment where we have zero corporate income tax, zero property tax, zero custom duties, zero value added tax, and half of the payroll tax rate. Another thing is labor market. Again, we have some limitations, we have some special requirements for attracting foreign laborers. But many experts are saying that the Russian labor code is one of the most liberal around the world. Yes, we have issues with customs. But based on the World Bank rating for custom administration, we improved a lot during the last 3 years, and now it's much better. So I can continue with the list, but the key point is that we do have issues, but we are improving every year and tackling these issues successfully, and I think people feel better over time when they're working in Russia. Thank you.
Alexei, a question from, I guess this is from Aalto University people. Aalto is a very great supporter of Slush and the whole economy here. So is Caltech, the research part, now I'm talking research, not startups, are those research for individual researchers or universities, are those also open or somehow once again limited to MIT only? There are quite a lot of such questions actually from the audience. And is there a corporate programs if you want to do research with Skoltech?
Well, we don't have corporate programs. We organize research at Skoltech under the concept of Centers of Research, Education and Innovation. And in each of these centers, we have an international partner. And MIT is only a partner in some of them. So we have partnerships with universities in Europe, in Asia, in the United States. That's the core principle. We do not want to just focus on one, even though a significant and important partnership. And with Aalto University, by the way, we had a great series of meetings today, both on the research front and on the student exchange front and the innovation front. So I'm hopeful that this will grow into a very good partnership, because we are very similar in ambition, in spirit, and in the approach how we want to do things. So that's actually a very good thing to happen here.
One thing to add, when we're talking about partnerships, it's important that you'd like to partner with people even more than with entities, with universities. I want people to be in Russia, as I just mentioned. It's important to be inside the country, to work at the place. When a person is telling to us, well, I will spend 15% of my time in Skolkovo or in Novosibirsk, whatever it is, we are thinking, no, we are ready to pay you more, but you have to stay more than 50%. 15, 30 is not enough. More than 50%, and then you will be a part of our project.
Precisely, yeah.
And as part of the commercial break, we are hiring faculty at Skoltech, and the information is available on skoltech.ru.
Da-da. Then a question. Yesterday I was seated with a very interesting and great Japanese colleague, and the Japanese colleague was asking, this is a question for all of you, if I say that Moscow is not the all of Russia, which city he should come to see Russian startups, and this is now top of your mind, and which industry, if you will select from this list what we have on the screen from the startup village, because a startup tour, because startup tour is open for anybody to join to these events. There is a translations and so forth, so you can follow. So let's have a quick poll. Arkady, you don't need to answer because then it would seem as a statement of government, but Dima, you start.
I think most of the cities on the map deserve visiting. St. Petersburg, obviously, Kazan, Nizhny Novgorod, Yekaterinburg, Tomsk. But also I can give an example. One of our best companies in portfolio comes from Ulyanovsk. This is a really kind of small, not too small, but there are hundreds of cities like Ulyanovsk in Russia. So basically you need to visit many of those.
I will say that I will not suggest to start from Moscow at all, since what we did recently, comparing our study with Facebook, we found that more interesting companies coming from the, not from Moscow. Reason, Moscow has too many clubs and too fancy life, and possibly very easy to make money for smart people by in different businesses and in startup. So we found that more guys coming from other cities. So I will start from other cities. And after this, since they anyway sometimes moving to Moscow, they moving to Finland or to Europe or to States. But in general, they starting from some remote cities.
Yeah, I would encourage people to go to the Far East, to Vladivostok, especially those who want to start a gaming company, to do gaming, because there's a huge gaming market in Asia. And there's a lot of good software engineers in Vladivostok produced by the Far Eastern Federal University. And that's a developing region, so I would recommend that. And of course, all the other cities on the map as well.
My suggestion would be to start with Vladivostok and then go city by city to the west and come back to Helsinki.
The last question, and then we have to move on. We'll show you some other material. Our crazy friend here in Finland, Mr. Vesterbakka, Peter Vesterbakka, the mighty eagle, he made a joke that, not a joke, 2 years ago, that there are three neighboring superpowers of startups, China, Russia, and Finland. Well, it sounds like a funny thing. Actually, the Chinese prime minister said to me that only the Finn can invent such an idea, superpowers of startups. But actually, Arkady, I just want to ask, because I saw a lot of the Chinese cooperation in open innovations in Moscow. We have here a lot of hundreds of Russian colleagues. We have Chinese colleagues. Is this now becoming a reality? I mean, and why we are doing it? What is the take for you?
It is becoming a reality. We started with learning from our Finnish friends, from our Finnish partners. I remember a few years ago, back in 2008, my first trip, I think, to learn about the innovation system was to Finland, and we made lessons from that. We really extracted, I think, some of the best things from what Finland was doing. Now there is a real drive in our cooperation with China, and it's not only about gas. Gas deal is a big one, but it's about also small businesses working together and making joint businesses. It's a tough road to go, but we took this road. We took this road together, and we can continue going.
Very good. Thank you, gentlemen. To finalize this session, first of all, I would like to invite on behalf of the Russian Federation and everybody in this team, you to join precisely 6 months after, in June 2015, we have a startup village where we have about 15,000 people, entrepreneurs all over Russia, from all of Europe. And last year we had about 200 Finnish entrepreneurs and investors there. We are doing it together with Startup Sauna. So this is like, it's not an accident that this happens first in darkness, like today, and 6 months after, it's a sunny Moscow there. So this is like the circle. And we really try to strengthen the region, and not only do the investment standpoint, but from the learning from the other companies. So we have here 52 companies in our Skolkovo booth here. You can meet all of them, talk with them from the cooperation standpoint. You don't need to be the investor, but how you can combine your product and access to the Russian market, or how they can build the entities here in Helsinki if they want to have access to the European market. So, yeah.
I fully support this invitation from the Russian government. You are invited to Russia, to a Startup Village in June 2015. Sunny weather at Skolkovo plus nightlife afterwards, I think, and the best theaters and museums that will make you satisfied.
And you all have a view about Russia, and in 7 seconds, you will see 2 minutes what a startup scene, what a startup village actually means in Russia. Спасибо большое. Thank you very much. Video, run.
Thank you.